We may also use all or part of it in our platforms and publications. We encourage you to get your questions in early, even while the presentation is going on. You may send in your questions by typing them in the chat box. When we call on you for your question, we will turn your mic on. Please state the name and organization. Please state your name and organization before asking your question. We also want to encourage everyone to turn on their video during today's session to better engage with our facilitators. If you're able to, we would like to request everyone to turn on your video now. Thank you. We've created a Facebook group for all the participants of the Digital Democracy Training Session. This group will serve as a space to share ideas and support each other in the digital democracy initiatives in our own cities. If you haven't already, please join the Facebook group through the link being shared in the chat box. To begin today's program, I would like to invite everyone to stand for the Philippine National Anthem. Thank you. Please be seated. Before we start today's program, I want to ask everyone if they have already answered the pretest. Please give us a thumbs up if you have. I can see that. Yes. All right. I can see that a few of you have. If you haven't, please answer it now. The link is being shared on the chat box. Thank you. To officially start the program, let me call on Catch Afilada, Senior Policy Officer of the Makati Business Club. Catch?
Hi, good morning, everyone. I hope you're all well. Welcome to Digital Democracy, Technology for Community Building and Decision Making. So this is an initiative of the Makati Business Club and the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung. This is as part of our Digital Democracy Project. So we created the Digital Democracy Project to use tech to bring communities together, while others use it to tear us apart, and to help governments talk with their constituents and work together on policies that create jobs. So we have so far worked with Pasig, Legazpi, Intramuros, and Iligan to conduct citizen assemblies online. We started with turning streets into additional space for retail, restaurants, and recreation in Pasig, to making streets more tourism-friendly in Manila, and ending with helping small businesses in Legazpi and Iligan. So everything that we have learned in the past 2 years have been condensed into a series of guidebooks on digital democracy, sharing the lessons we have learned in conducting digital democracy in the middle of the pandemic. So based on these guidebooks, today's activity is designed to empower LGUs to use digital democracy tools to listen to their constituents. By the end of the session, you in the room today will be able to conduct your own digital democracy process in your own city. So to conduct the training, we have Dr. Dexter Galban and Dr. Pia Roderos of Experto Play Lab. So Experto is a global advocacy-based social enterprise. They focus on management consultancy and professional and training development. So Dr. Dex Galban will be conducting the training today. He's a commissioner of the Commission on Population and Development in NEDA, and he's the CEO of Experto Play Labs. Dr. Dex will briefly explain concepts, And MBC, myself, and Gita will provide concrete examples based on our experience. So Dr. Bia will be presenting tomorrow. She's the COO of Experto Play Labs, where she developed a learning and management platform for health, climate, education, and governance. We look forward to today's discussions and breakout sessions. To get us started, here's Dr. Dex. Dr. Right. Dex,
there you go. Great. Good day, everyone. Welcome to our training session for today, organized by the Makati Business Club alongside KS and with the support of Experto Play Labs. Today, we will be diving into a very important component of what will be the future of governance. And of course, that will include our introduction to you today to digital democracy. So once again, I'm Dr. Commissioner Dexter Galban, and as part of Experto Play Labs team and the MBC team, we welcome you to this training session. So since we're talking about digital democracy, we would first like to get everyone in this call familiar with using some of the tools that are readily available. So through your devices, whether it's through your mobile phone or through your, let's say, desktop or laptop, please log into menti.com and input the following information. Or you can also choose to scan the QR code in order for us to jump into our very first interactive session. Right? Because today we want all of you to answer the quick question: on a scale of 1 being the lowest to 5 being the highest, how are you feeling today? Are you feeling great? Are you feeling wonderful, energized, but sluggish? Probably it's the midweek hump. So encouraging everyone to answer. We'll keep using this platform as a way to get everyone used to using digital democracy tools for the benefit of rapid responses and getting the feedback of your constituents. So again, go to menti.com and use the code here, 78726205. And just keep it on because we'll be using it quite a lot today. So we have some responses already. So we're seeing not that super great, but still on the positive side, we hope to get more responses as more of you send in your thoughts and feedback, right? Okay, so we'll probably leave this on for probably about 30 more seconds. Let us know so that we can hopefully help push you towards feeling wonderful, learning better, and having more positive feedback after our digital democracy training. So yes, keep those answers coming. Probably we have about 15 seconds to go. All right. Okay, there you go. So thank you for your responses. So everyone has a bit of a mixed response, wherein we see a lot of people still ready to go, with some already feeling the midweek hump. All right, so let's jump into a very important segment that we need to identify today, which is this. Okay, again, thank you very much to all of the responses. Let's jump into our very next question, and it's this one. Since you're all coming from different government agencies and or local government units, I think it's time for us to understand probably where you're coming from or what you're representing. So let's go to our next question. What part of government are you representing? Because right now we have a large expanse of people joining us. See, as you see here in terms of LGU context, whether you're from national or local government, part of a province, a city that's highly urbanized, or probably a barangay level official, we hope to know what you're representing and where you're coming from so we can make all your learning a bit more customized and more relatable, right? So there you go. So we see here quite a lot for this session coming from highly urbanized or independent cities in general, and we still have some from the provincial government. Yeah, great. Thank you for sending it over. Okay, we have some coming from municipalities. Thank you so much for this information. This would be very helpful in probably helping MBC better provide good examples or maybe even reach out to you for future collaborations. Great. Thank you very much for your responses and keep them going. I'll be leaving this right on for you to fill up. We'll visit this in just a bit. So today we're here to talk about digital democracy, right? And you got a little taste of it already. So it doesn't matter what current status you are in terms of your rank in government or what you're currently a part of, but we want to show you that through digital democracy, you'll be able to helpfully improve the way that your agency or municipality runs. Because digital democracy is really using information and communication technology in all kinds of media for primarily the purposes of enhancing political democracy or the participation of citizens in the democratic communications process, right? Again, this does not aim to replace traditional or face-to-face consultations. Instead, it wants to complement it and reinforce existing democratic practices by introducing ICT as well as new innovations for your benefit. And later you'll hear about the stories about the Makati Business Club and the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung working with different LGUs and cities in order to make things happen, right? And do take note that digital democracy may differ from project to project. And what we hope to do is make you realize that following the step-by-step process, everyone can integrate digital democracy into their daily functions. So let's jump into it. It's very important also to highlight that digital democracy is a multi-sector endeavor from the local government unit, civil society, businesses, media, the academe, individuals in general. There is a vast representation that's needed for us to really dive into what the public needs from their government. And this is particularly important because what we want to do or achieve would be to increase participation of diverse stakeholders, generate a whole lot more or increase the range of ideas that we are able to get from the public and to co-create solutions, because solutions, projects, and programs are better implemented and abided to if they are co-owned by the people who are part of the solution-making process, right? So since we're talking about digital democracy, today we will focus on the six steps. And this is championed by MDC, from planning to creating the survey to opening your citizen assembly, collecting and analyzing your data, closing that citizen assembly, and of course, closing the loop when it comes to rolling out your digital democracy projects, right? So you cannot talk about digital democracy without talking about e-governance, because e-governance basically is the use of digital means by public administration to exercise the function and delivery of public services. What this does is it informs government decision-making with data. It can even enhance resilience in the face of emergencies, can make your local government unit more attractive to businesses and investments, since they know that your unit really relies on data and actively corresponds with the public when it comes to creating these decisions and programs. And since we're talking about e-governance, we have to talk about how digital democracy is part of e-governance and is actually a driver of good governance. And since a lot of people here are from government, we have to definitely highlight the components of good governance, particularly first, it being participatory. So it means all constituents should have a voice in government decision-making processes, as well as consensus-oriented, meaning the differing interests are mediated to reach a broader consensus even amongst different sectors of the community. Accountable, particularly so that key decision makers in the community, whether they're part of government or the private sector, CSOs, are held accountable for anything that happens within your municipality or your city, plus transparent so that you can have complete, up-to-date, and relevant information regarding all government decisions, processes, and policies. And of course, since we're talking about government, one thing that we love the most is it being responsive. So it means that there are processes, institutions, and systems to make all the delivery of these services done within a reasonable amount of time. And we want definitely an equitable and inclusive, less efficient rule of law, particularly so that all the members of the community, regardless of age, race, gender, social status, all have equal access to the services and opportunities in society, right? And what we hope to do is hopefully share with you some of the success stories that we have. And for that, I would love to call Ms. Gita to share with us some of the past experiences of MDC regarding the digital democracy pilots.
Thank you so much, Dex. Before I actually dive deep into the cases, I just want to acknowledge and thank the presence of some members in the room right now. They actually helped us with the citizen assemblies last year. So in the room with us, we have Mr. Carlos Ante from the Legazpi city. We worked with him very closely during the Legazpi citizen assembly last year. And we also have in the room with us Mr. Jeffrey Yap from the Intramuros administration, who we also worked with when conducting our assemblies last year. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and I hope we can also hear from you later on about how we conducted the citizen assembly with you. So just jumping right in 2020, we started our first pilot of the Digital Democracy Project was held in Pasig. Do you think could we go to the next slide, Dex? So in this case, the Pasig city government asked its citizens what they thought about open streets. In Pasig, over 514 people voted and expressed support for open streets in general, but raised concerns on traffic congestion and illegal parking. Next slide. The success of the pilot in Pasig led MBC to pursue a second pilot run in 2021 with Pasig, Legazpi, and Iligan, as well as Intramuros. In June 2021, Pasig City asked citizens what they thought about enforcing a 30-kilometer speed cap in urban centers. 471 people voted and showed that cyclists, pedestrians, and commuters agreed with speed caps, while car owners were hesitant. Both groups, however, agreed that walking and cycling improves health, reduces traffic, and is good for tourism and local businesses. Next slide. In July 2021, we worked with the Intramuros administration. They asked their citizens what they thought about turning General Luna into a pedestrian-only zone. 1,064 people voted and showed a strong agreement with pedestrian-only streets and on the benefits of walking and biking close to home. However, voters also raised concern regarding road safety, parking space, and accommodations for PWDs, and flooding, among others. Next slide. In August 2021, the Legazpi city government wanted to better understand. Next slide, please. In August 2021, the Legazpi city government wanted to better understand what support family-owned MSMEs needed to grow. 338 people voted and showed that businesses that used digital technology wanted support in digital transformation, while those that did not wanted support in business succession planning and financial management. The voters also expressed concern about the sufficiency of utilities, the lack of information, knowledge, and funds to register micro businesses and to comply with rules and regulations. They also expressed concern about the lack of a go-to office that provides assistance to businesses. And finally, voters were a little concerned about the Mayon volcano and its accompanying hazards. Then finally, our last run in September 2021, Iligan City government asked its MSMEs, both registered and unregistered, what support they needed to survive, grow, and contribute to economic recovery. All respondents expressed that they felt COVID-19's negative impact on their business and felt that there's not enough policy in Iligan to support freelancers. The voters also shared that they need support in marketing, finance, and digital transformation. They need support in regulatory compliance and business registration, and that they need better equipment and technology. So this is a very short and quick summary of the five case studies we had in 2020 to 2021. Back at you, Dex.
Thank you for that, Ms. Gita. And as you can see, this is something that has been championed by MDC and KAS for quite a long time. And we have seen wonderful results through the pilot programs done in these wonderful locations and these different government units. And we encourage all of you to hopefully collaborate also with MDC in order to make things happen in your municipality or your locality. So let's jump back into our discussion, because today we will be guiding you through that six-step process, particularly planning, survey, open assembly, collect and analyze, close the assembly, complete the loop, all of these things in order for you to practice digital democracy within your LGU. And of course, since this is a six-step process, we have to start with step number one, and that would definitely be planning. And when you talk about planning, you would definitely need to understand what issues do we need for the community to give feedback on. What is it that you need to learn from the community, or what you want to ask from the community in order for you to successfully somehow develop a better understanding of what they need, right? So again, I'd love to ask all of you who are currently able to access another device to log into menti.com, or you probably scan the QR code in order for us to find out a little bit more about what you think would be things or issues that should be addressed, that can be addressed using digital democracy. So again, this is the representation again. So it looks like we have a lot of representatives from cities, right? So let's now go into the next question, which will dive into what you believe would be the main issues that can be responded to when it comes to digital democracy. All right, here we go. So please answer, what issue does your LGU face which can benefit from digital democracy? So feel free to write any word, any thought. Is it about environment? Is it about traffic? Is it about health? What is it that you think would definitely be a major topic wherein your constituents or the general public, those within your locality, would want to provide input about? Probably because it's close to home. Probably it's because something that's very urgent or concerning. So we hear very first answer from one of our participants today. Big gaping explanation here. Issues here on health, traffic, sports. Interesting. We're having a bit of variety in responses. Data security. Interesting. ICT. MSME support. Wonderful. Great. Let's probably wait for a few more. And I think we're getting a bit more responses coming in. So we see here, it looks like health and traffic are the leading responses. Internet connectivity, communication, voice of the people, right? Change of jurisdiction, very interesting. I think that would be concerning given the recent news about the changes in designation. Yeah, very interesting. Elections. Of course, we are just days away from a national and local election fever pitch. All right, paperless. All right, we're getting a bit more responses coming in. Good. Probably we can extend the session for about 30 seconds more, just so we can have probably more dominant answer coming off here. But so far, it looks like a lot are unifying behind the issues of health and traffic. Well, maybe they're related, right? So yeah, health and traffic definitely leading the rest of the discussions with all the respondents rallying behind them. Okay, so for it just goes to show that for at least for this group of public servants, health and traffic appear to be the top priorities when it comes to wanting to know how the public can contribute when it comes to solution building, or probably seeking feedback with regard to probably what steps the government can consider to address them. Great. So let's jump back in. So when you're talking about choosing a topic, probably you're wondering what would be the best approach. And sorry, I think we had a bit of a change here. Let me just jump back in a bit. Sorry, we have a bit of technical concerns, but yes, let's jump back into our discussion. Right, so here we have digital democracy, as mentioned a while ago, and let's just go back to our slide of discussion. Right, so again, when we talk about digital democracy, we're here to plan. What issues do we need to probably respond to? So to give you a bit of context, this is the time wherein you would need to identify the answers to your WH questions. First, begin with why, right? Identify your subject for consultation, the significance of that topic. Why are you talking about that topic? Why are you talking about health? Why are you talking about traffic? Like, then you have to ask the what. Identify key information regarding those things, right? What do we know about the traffic in your locality? What do we know about health in your locality? And we have to prioritize how we are able to get this information, how we collect this information. Then you have to talk about who. Who are the stakeholders? Do we have to talk to every single person, or do we have to get representative groups? Or is it possible for us to target some particular number of respondents for a particular demographic? And at the same time, you have to ask how. How now do we make these things happen? How do we get the responses within a specified amount of time? How can we do that given our existing technological capacity? All of these considerations have to be factored in. So just the planning stage alone, this is actually the lay of the land. Typically, it would take about a week to create your questionnaire. Then about a month to plan the citizen assembly, meaning you're going to build that group that will help you craft your database of answers or responses and probably give you the results that you're looking for. Then you have another 3 weeks to 4 weeks, practically almost another month, for feedback collection. Then a very rigorous 2 weeks for analysis of feedback, because for sure, you have to clean your data, you have to ensure that everything is aligned and everything is working as planned. So with that being said, I think you have to consider the different stakeholders that would have to come into play when you are talking about planning the next step. So definitely you would have to talk to, and I'll go through this in order here, I'll probably put my cursor there. First would be government. You would definitely need to talk about government because you would need to coordinate with your existing individuals within government, your LGU, your barangay, and if possible, coordinate with national government if it concerns them. Then you would talk to your CSOs, the general public, your community leaders, whether it's formalized or informal, or probably those that you believe would have a significant stake. Even your religious groups will factor into the decision-making process as well. Then you would look into the inputs and thoughts of your businesses. Remember, these are the ones helping fuel the growth and economy of your locality, of your municipality. So having them as part of the conversation would definitely be very important in any decision-making process as well. Plus, you can also consider reaching out to NGOs, nonprofits, and those that are coordinating with international development agencies. And since we're talking about information, processing data, and the value of it being done in the correct way, probably coordinating with the academe, whether local or national, would be very helpful because we have different centers of excellence, we have different groups that specialize in a particular discipline or study. So reaching out to the academe would definitely be a good way to get a holistic picture. And of course, and this is something that would typically be forgotten by LGUs or government in general when it comes to having a voice within their consultation pool, because they're usually seen as adjunct. Actually, you also need to consult media. How are you going to communicate this better? How are you going to reach your target audience better? How do you craft the subject matter or probably frame it in the context that would generate the right responses or enough responses for them to be validated? As you can see here, you have the interaction. If you look to the right, the interaction between government, that would be politicians, political parties, the public authority in general. Plus, as you see here, we'll discuss this a little bit tomorrow, the digital democracy officer that MBC and KAS are championing, and you can read more about that in the handbook, and how they relate and intersect with media, CSOs, private sector, NGOs, and even the academe. So with that being said, I think this would be a good time once again to know more about what has happened in the past, and particularly being able to select a topic. So maybe we can call on Ms. Kat Chapilada to share more about how we can better select our topics moving forward.
Thank you, Dex. Before we jump to Catch, would it be all right? I'd like to call on Mr. Jeffrey Yap of the Intramuros Administration. If you could just unmute yourself and perhaps share with us for about a minute or two, what was the topic that we discussed during the Citizen Assembly in Intramuros last year in 2021?
Good morning, everyone. I hope my audio is clear.
Coming in loud and clear.
Okay, that's good to know. Yes, we had the Citizens Assembly last July in Intramuros, and we gathered a positive response on the need to pedestrianize the General Luna Street. In fact, in the succeeding months, we are actually about to implement it, hopefully by this year. We have gathered the stakeholders. We believe that it's very essential for us to ensure that the people living in Intramuros are aware of what's going to happen and the advantages of the pedestrianization. So we gathered them last month. Hopefully after the elections, we will be coming up with a sticker program where it will be more organized for the vehicles passing through Intramuros to be diverted to other streets. Because General Luna will be pedestrianized, almost a kilometer stretch of it, exclusively for bikers, tourists, and the kalesas. So we've been very grateful for the Makati Business Club for organizing the Citizens Assembly last year, because it spearheaded actually in its park interest and gained more attention to our advocacy to pedestrianize the tourism sites and the heritage sites of Manila, particularly the walled city.
Thank you so much, Mr. Jeffrey, for sharing with us this morning. Back at you, Catch.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, Sir Jeffrey, and of course, Intramuros Administration for sharing about that. So as Dr. Dex was saying, when you want to choose a topic among your LGUs, among your different priorities, the most important one is to talk to your team or to your management head what you want to specifically focus on. So as Sir Jeffrey was mentioning, Intramuros Administration was focused on heritage conservation and modernization at the same time. So they chose a narrow topic, a very specific topic of pedestrianization of General Luna Street. So this is specific. It specifies which street they want to conduct the project on, and it specifies what specifically they want to do on that street. They chose this because they already had a clear scope for their policies. So if they didn't mention the street, it would open discussions to the other streets that they don't want to tackle. So by specifying General Luna Street, they want to avoid misconceptions that other streets would also be closed off. But on the other hand, Pasig City Transport focused on transportation. They were looking at lowering speed limits within the city center of Pasig itself to lessen fatalities in serious car accidents. So this could be a very controversial policy, because a lot of people have a conception that if you lower speed limits, you'll make traffic worse. So what they wanted to do was to start a general discussion on speed limits. So they chose a broad topic, low speed streets, for their digital democracy process. So I also wanted to ask everybody today, maybe you could let Sir Jeffrey know in the chat if you have visited the San Agustin Church in Intramuros. Let us know in the chat, or perhaps raise your hand. So I've visited that church and I love that street. I can definitely see why Intramuros Administration wanted to preserve it. So if you look around that street, I see, hi, Mr. Jerry Lim. I see that he has also visited San Agustin Church. So the church around, or the streets around San Agustin Church, are lined with cobblestones. And many other sites like the Manila Cathedral are located there. So the reason Intramuros wanted to consider General Luna, was to consider closing General Luna, was to preserve the integrity of the San Agustin Church, which was being damaged by the vibrations of passing heavy vehicles, as well as to preserve the cobblestone streets. let us know in the chat or magyabag na rin kayo, sir. Sabihin nyo na kung meron din kayong mga heritage areas within your LGUs. So while we're doing that, I'll turn back to Doc Dex to talk more about the formulation of survey questions. So as you can see, Doc Dex, how broad or narrow the topic is entirely depends on the agenda of the LGU.
Absolutely correct, Ms. Cash. So you can go very broad or very specific, depending on the context that your LGU currently has its sights on. So whether you're talking about a small topic or a large topic, something that needs a larger consensus, or something that just concerns a smaller group of individuals, it'll be definitely up to you. Because once you have your plan, once you have your topic in place, once you know who you want to reach out to, then that means you have to move on to the next part of our sixth step process. And that would be creating your survey, right? And when you talk about the survey, this would be how the questions are created, how they are phrased, and these would be very critical in the entire process itself. And taking into account that when you formulate questions, there are some guidelines that we actually recommend that you follow. First and foremost, we encourage you to ask questions that are clear and specific. So we encourage you to use simple and concrete language to be better understood by respondents. And at the same time, we highly advise this time against the use of jargon, something that may be too technical for a particular specialization, technical area, professional group, etc. So you would like to avoid using these very area-specific terms to make yourself a little bit easier to understand by the general public. Then you have to avoid being redundant and having biases. So first, with being redundant, you don't ask the same question in a different way, because it's not only inefficient, but it can also yield very conflicting results when you are actually able to get both of them at the same time. And when it comes to biases, you hopefully would be able to frame your questions in a way that is not offensive to any gender, race, religion, or any sectoral group or non-sectoral group that you are hopefully reaching out to. So for example, if you're going to talk about education, probably you're going to talk about asking them what their specific highest level of education attainment would be, in contrast to asking them, have you finished this or have you finished that, etc. And also, we highly encourage you to adhere to the rules and policies of the Data Privacy Act of 2012. We'll talk about that a little bit more when we talk about data processing and management. And of course, as in everything, when you have your survey done, you would definitely want to test that out within a small group to ensure that you're able to roll it out properly. If there are anything or any questions that might be confusing, you'd be able to tweak them out. If you want to be very scientific with it, there is actually your content and content validity testing and your inter-rater validity testing as well. So when it comes to that, maybe it would be best for us to give you a taste on identifying what is a good survey question and what is a bad survey question. So once again, please scan the Mentimeter code that's on the screen right now or visit menti.com and input the voting code as we jump to another quick response from all of you. So again, clearly, looks like internet connectivity is catching up with health and traffic. So, very interesting. Maybe we'll see those as your top issues at the end of the program. So let's now jump to the actual next question, which would be this. Which among these, based on your assessment, is a bad survey question? Which among the following is a bad survey question? Okay. So the first is, are you currently undergoing your secondary education in an accredited learning institution? Or what is your civil status? What gender do you identify with? Do you agree with having a stop sign at the intersection of Blue Drive and Red Avenue? So let's see, what is the feedback of our participants today? It looks like there is a split. Very interesting. Very interesting. It looks like our participants are split. Oh, we have another one. Great. So probably we'll leave this on for about 15 seconds more, just so we can get a more dominant answer from the crowd. So it looks like, oh gosh, it looks like it's a race between two options. Very interesting, right? So probably we'll close this in about 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. So it looks like coming in, it's quite, oh wow, just at the nick of time. Now it's a tie. Great. Is anyone going to come in to break the tie? Okay, someone tried to. Okay, two people broke the tie. All right. So it looks like the dominant answer is the first one, which is, are you currently undergoing your secondary education in an accredited learning institution? So I'd like to ask anyone among the 13 who just narrowly beat out the other option to tell us why you think this was the bad survey question. Any response from our participants? There are people rallying behind this question now. I think I have a feeling this is the right answer. So what is the reason? I'd like to ask anyone of our participants to tell us, why do you think this is a bad survey question? Right. So again, these are the things to consider. So I'd like to ask, why do you think this is the bad survey question? Or probably we can ask a volunteer whether or not you were the ones who answered it. Okay, we have a hand raised. I think this is from the Makati LGU. Sir Jerry Lim. Sir, are you volunteering to answer our question? Why is it a bad survey question? All right. So it looks like sir is unable to...
Yeah, I think that might be from the previous question of... You visited. All right,
no worries. No worries.
But we have something from the chat here.
Great. You can also respond via the chat box. Okay, so great. So we have one from the city of Makati, Clara Cruzado. Right, so the answer is, it is like discriminating from what school you came from. Yes, that's part of the consideration. Yes. Any other answers? Very interesting feedback. Any other answers from our participants? Why is this the concerning question? Actually, in part, that might be true, depending on the context. But one of the major considerations here is that the way that the question was phrased is that it can be very complex or overwhelming. Wherein a very simple way to ask this question is, are you currently in high school? That is the very plain language equivalent of this question. And that's what makes it a little bit more concerning. It's an intimidating question, right? Exactly. Wherein you used all of these big, heavy words instead of a plain question like, are you currently in high school? Perfect. And I can understand, just probably we can figure out why there was this big split regarding the first and second option. Can anyone give me a bit of a feedback as to why the second question almost beat out the first question? Any thoughts? You can answer in the chat box if you're unable to mute your microphone. My big guess here is that because it deals with gender, so maybe there is a bit of sensitivity with regard to that topic. So in case that would be your area of concern, definitely. Very good. I think we have a response here from Rhea Lisa from the LGU of Bulacan. Not everybody is open to reveal their gender. Wonderful. Very, very good. So that is a good consideration as well. But of course, if your policy is going to be about gender, having an idea regarding what your constituency group would be representing would be good. So again, it will be dependent on the context. But very good considerations, and I applaud all of you for catching that. Now let's move on to another question. So let's just get these evaluation juices going. So which among the following is a bad survey question? So the first one is, in the past 6 months, have you used the e-registration platform of Brown City Local Government? the next question is, are you only a high school graduate? The third option must be, what is your current annual income bracket? Please select from the choices. Okay? And the last would be, how many dependents does your family unit currently have? Okay, so please feel free to vote. I wonder if we're going to have a tight race this time, but it appears that there is a runaway winner. There's a runaway winner. Great. So as we see all of the responses coming in, I'd love to ask through the chat box, if you're unable to mute your microphone, why do you think this is the wrong answer? Why is this the bad survey question? What is it that makes this such a horrible question to put in your survey? Love to have some feedback from the chat box. Noreen, great. So again, from Realiza, yeah, there is concurrence here, right? From Makati and from Bulacan, the use of the word only. It's like it's somehow derogatory or you're limiting an individual. Very good. Thank you very much. And probably last question, because I think we're having a bit of fun looking at all of your responses. Which among the following is a bad survey question? So which barangay do you currently reside in? Please select from the options below. In the past month, how many times have you visited the barangay health center? The third would be, how many years have you been a registered resident of Violet City? And last is, do you agree with the proposal that the city procures AED for BHWs via PPP with TMC? So I'd love to know your responses.
Okay, so that's a real question, Dex. What is a BHW?
Yes.
And what is a TMC?
Yes. So AEDs are used for your emergency situations, though your defibrillators, and BHWs are your barangay health workers, PPPs, public-private partnerships, and TMC is a sample of a hospital in Pasig City. So that is MC, very, very MC, interesting. See, so it can be quite overwhelming with all of these acronyms that not everyone would know about. So I think we have a runaway winner. I'd love to know, though, it appears that everyone's in agreement that the last question is concerning. But I'd love to know, especially those who answered, how many years have you been a registered resident of Violet City? I'd love to know why you also noted that before we close this part of the program. Any feedback as to why you think that's a concerning question? My top guess would be profiling probably the residents or the constituents of your locality. It can be a bit concerning for some. Thank you for that. But yeah, I think everyone is in agreement that having these many acronyms can be quite overwhelming. So again, thank you very much for your responses. I'm enjoying all of you participating in our program. So with that being said, I think it would be time for us to jump into the next part of our discussion, right? So now we move on to steps 3 and 4. So first, let's go with step 3. Open assembly, particularly organizing a citizen assembly, right? So what is this all about? First, we have to understand that this part asks you to present the objectives for soliciting feedback through digital democracy, meaning you have to ask yourself, what is it that the public would like to know about this endeavor? So therefore, you have to tell them, these are the objectives of this survey. These are the objectives of this digital democracy initiative. Therefore, it would be critical for you to tell them what is the context by which you're engaging with the general public. So you have to present them the issue. Are you talking about the issue about the street? The issue about, let's say, waste segregation or health or probably a gender-related rule? What is the issue that you would like to ask them about? And then it would be good to have, as part of that assembly, some experts regarding the topic so that it's not just the general knowledge of the public, but really it's a bit guided given the fact that you will be having experts probably from the academe, from the sector that would be most involved, so that it feels a bit more targeted and a bit more congruent with the direction of the policy that you're creating. Then you have to contextualize it. Why now? Why at this moment? And what do you hope to happen after this is rolled out? And of course, you have to consider the diversity in terms of the representation. Because although you are targeting a particular sector or a particular locality, LGU, barangay group that will have or experience the impact of your policy or program, having a good representation of stakeholders, as mentioned a while ago, would be very helpful in order for you to understand the impact of your policy. How does this affect the businesses in the area? How does this affect the function of government in the area? Will this affect the academe? Will this have an issue with CSOs and NGOs? Maybe this has a concern regarding the nonprofits. Anything and everything, whether it is race, gender, age, etc., hopefully you would have a good mix in order to be fully represented when it comes to policymaking. And here we've outlined how you can reach out to them offline and online. And we included the offline part because we wanted to emphasize once again that digital democracy initiatives aren't meant to replace the traditional or the more face-to-face interactions. And they're really intended to complement it. So as you can see here, you can send invitations in person or via email. You can talk to local media. You can talk to them via, let's say, your online social media accounts. You can probably course them through if offline through your community leaders, your punong barangays, or probably send them out within a community page that they have subscribed to, or if your LGU has a giant Facebook group, etc. All of these considerations have to be factored in when creating your citizens' assembly. Great. And at this point in time, I think it would be wonderful to learn, at least based on the experiences of MBC and KAS, how do we better identify who should be brought in as part of the citizen assembly? How do we invite them? And who should we invite? And I think for this part, I'd love to call on Ms. Kita.
Thank you, Dex. Thank you for your explanation. So I'm just going to give you the example of Iligan City and Legazpi City. Both of them had the same topic, which is they wanted to understand how to better support MSMEs. So what we've learned from this digital democracy process is that who is invited to an opening or closing citizen assembly really depends on the priorities of the LGU. For example, in Iligan City in 2021, the LGU invited a diverse group of stakeholders, including local bank representatives, students, freelancers, government officials, and small business owners. The government invited this variety of participation to the assembly so that the different groups of people could come together and help spread the message about the assembly and provide ideas to the government on the survey collection process, and also to bring many heads together to provide feedback to the government on how to proceed. On the other hand, in Legazpi City, the LGU was very interested in hearing from the small business owners. During their citizen assemblies, they did invite a lot of stakeholders, but very, very importantly, they made sure to invite a large number of small business owners to participate with the aim of increasing the reach of the questionnaire to the target group of people, and also to hear from them their recommendation and asks from the government. As you can see, although both cities had the same issue to consider, the approach of who to invite to the assembly very much depended on the LGU's priorities. Back to you, Dex.
Thank you very much, Ms. Gita. And this is why I would love to ask our participants today, and hopefully you can tell me in the chat box, can you identify community ambassadors in your LGU? Who are your community leaders? Who do you ask for advice when it comes to creating policies? Who are your go-to people, right? So please do tell me that within the chat box as we proceed first to our next step, because of course we would love to go through the process with you. Now, the next step or the fourth step would be to collect and analyze your data. And this is absolutely very important for us to dive into. So when you collect and analyze data, this is really more about disseminating your digital survey and then subsequently processing the data that you collected after. And you can have many, many approaches when it comes to encouraging people to participate in your digital democracy initiative. You can have different tools. You can provide feedback. You can provide tokens or probably bundle it with benefits. For some, they would give load. For some, they would give goodies or probably make it contingent to a government handout or a giveaway, etc. And probably even bundle it when it comes to their social media engagements. So many mechanisms for us to encourage people to participate in the program. And these are just some of the mechanisms and tools that MBC highly recommend, particularly whether you're holding a meeting or an online event, creating a process or survey, and you'll learn more about a bit of these later on, particularly polis. Probably mechanisms to visualize and analyze your data. You can use Excel or Tableau, or if you're a little bit more advanced, you can even use Python, React Native JS, among others. And when it comes to this, you have to also account for some things. Okay, so I hope you can still see my slides. Great. Right, so let me just bump that back a bit. Let me go back a bit. So here, the challenges that you have to consider. So first, you have to take into account who has access to your survey, who has the capacity to really look into answering or giving you feedback when asking for assistance. What is the cost? What cost would it entail for your LGU to get the feedback, to get that information? And at the same time, what technologies do you currently have that's readily available to you in order for you to roll it out? And next would be, how much do you trust this process? Or how much do the public trust this tool or mechanism or platform in providing feedback? And how secure is this tool or this platform that will be used to collect the data of your constituents? All of these have to be factored in. And since I already talked about security, we have to talk about data privacy. As mentioned before, we highly encourage everyone to adhere to the Data Privacy Act of 2012. We're in, just to give you a very quick snapshot of what it's all about, number one thing that you need to include would be disclaimers and the seeking out of permission when it comes to consent. Second would be the relevance. When creating your survey questions, you have to ensure that the data that you just ask would be relevant to the purposes of your endeavor, right? And the third would be access. More so when you talk about who has access to the data collected. Is it just the officer receiving the content? Or is the raw data readily available to the entire team that's managing it? Or will it be open to the public? What would be the limits of access? And next would be the limits in terms of what would be the use? Because typically when you collect data, it's very purposive. And using data for purposes outside the realm that it was intended for can be very tricky and will be definitely a major concern with regards to data privacy, right? So again, as we continue, we highly encourage you to send in all your questions and concerns. And if you have anything to share, please do so in the chat box. All right. So at this point in time, I think we'd love to know more about the successes of the past, particularly the previous pilots. So I'd love to call on Ms. Cash to probably share with us the communication channels that they used for their citizen assemblies and which one was deemed to be most successful.
Thanks, Dr. So during the digital democracy run in the past 2 years, the LGUs and MBC, we use a lot of communication channels. We use social media, SMS text blasts, emails. We also reached out to community interest groups to disseminate the survey. So one, it's important to use the local language when promoting the survey. You're talking to your constituents, so you want to talk to them in the language that they understand and know best. Two, the channel or the website used can determine the tone of the feedback that we use. During the digital democracy run in Intramuros, they responded. Respondents submitted their votes via polis and also wrote comments on our Facebook page. We noticed that the suggestions we received from Facebook are much more extreme compared to the polis or to the comments that they would put on the polis platform. So, for example, on the next slide, we'll see an example of this. All right, there. So on Facebook, the comments would recommend closing the entire Intramuros to motorized vehicles. But in the same comment or the same commenter on police would recommend or narrow it down. He would only recommend the closure of specific roads. We also noticed that comments on police are more detailed, especially when it comes to disagreements. So people talk about why they disagree rather than just blanket disagreeing with a policy. Facebook comments would tend to just kind of express frustration without specific policy recommendations. So we should note that although comments received from social media, they have a wealth of feedback data from stakeholders, and usually it's a lot easier for them to access this. It may not necessarily represent all sectors. And some respondents may be hesitant to voice out concerns publicly, while concerns and disagreement with the policy is more voiced out via other platforms like Polis. Okay. So just wanted to ask our participants as well, right before we hit our coffee break, which social media channels do you think is the most effective for your constituency?
Great. Thank you for that, Ms. Catch. And to help you with that, let's use a digital democracy tool that can hopefully help us visualize that. So again, please visit the Mentimeter that is currently on in your other devices. And let's take a look. So we're seeing here some of the responses here from your previous questions. Now here, in your opinion, what is the most effective social media channel? So these are just some of the most popular ones in the Philippines, from Facebook to YouTube to TikTok, Twitter, Instagram, and even our very own Filipino-based Kumu. So which one is the most effective social media channel, or maybe the one that you use for your local government unit? So please do let us know, and let's see which is king. Right, because I believe right now, for the 7th year in a row, the Philippines is the social media capital of the world. So let's see, what is the preferred one for the Filipinos? Right, so with that being said, we will now be, please just continue answering. I'll just keep it flashed for just a bit. But we will now be moving on to our much-awaited coffee break. And for this, I turn you over to our dear friends from the Makati Business Club.
Coffee break. Sorry about that. Please mute yourself. Everest.
The Digital Democracy Project uses online platforms to gather citizens' thoughts. Polis is the online surveying tool being used in this project. It's a way to gather open-ended feedback from large group of people online. Polis is powered by artificial intelligence, or AI. City governments around the world use it to inform decision-making. In fact, it was used by the Taiwanese government to decide on issues around Uber and other ride-sharing apps. These are the three stages to initiate an online conversation: create, vote, and analyze. In the first stage, create, city government employees and MBC staff create a Polis conversation by adding statements to vote on. Then, we invite participants to the conversation. In the second stage, vote, the conversation is run online. Participants click on a link to arrive at a survey where they can vote agree, disagree, or pass on statements in the conversation. Participants may also add statements of their own and have other participants vote on them. In the final stage, analyze, the voting behavior of participants is analyzed by AI in real time. Our data science partner, LayerTech, analyzes the information and is presented to the city government for their action. Makati Business Club and the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung organized the Citizen Assembly. It aims to support governments in measuring public opinion and to use technology to gather citizen input to improve initiatives, programs, and policies.
That ends our coffee break this morning. I hope you were able to grab your water, tea, or coffee. Before we begin again, I invite everyone to follow and like us on social media to keep yourself updated on our events. The link to our pages are seen on screen and is also being shared on the chat box now.
All right, thank you very much for that, Ms. Gita. And probably as a good way to jump into the next part, since we're already starting to talk about data, there's a question here from Makati LGU. The question is from Laveria, AB. Do you exclude some responses if it seems to be irrelevant? Or do you include all responses and find connection with those disconnected responses? This is where you would need really the help of experts, because there really is a process when it comes to data collection and why creating the proper, well-crafted survey is very important, because it allows you to get the right responses and will exclude automatically, by the way that it was framed, irrelevant questions or irrelevant responses, sorry, that might be related to your area of concern. And at the same time, it will also give you the vibe of what would be the expected outcome, since there would be a limitation to the number of choices, or probably give you a more satisfying output when it comes to really presenting the data back to them, given that they had to just select which among the choices would be their most preferred, or probably whether they agree with something or not. And these questions that are a bit more open-ended should be done primarily during focus group discussions, or probably more in-depth analysis when conducting them with your constituents, in contrast to, say, a very, very large survey or probably a sample group. Okay. So with that being said, I hope you can all see my screen. We'll jump right back into our discussion for today. So let's get to it. Let's now talk about data analysis, right? This is going to be quite interesting because it's about making sense of the digital democracy responses, as mentioned a while ago. So how do you turn data into information? So let's look at some considerations that we have to take into account, because you have all of these amazing tools. As mentioned, you can use digital spreadsheets, you can use platforms like what we're using right now, Zoom for your online meetings or your online surveys. You can have a cloud platform, you can use Polis, as mentioned. You can use data visualization tools. I hope you are enjoying yourself as you saw your responses flying through the screen in Mentimeter. And you can even use social media as a mechanism to get feedback. So all of these amazing tools at your disposal, but what are now your considerations when it comes to processing the data? Well, for some LGUs that are much larger with a lot more people, there might be a possibility that you have the technical capacity to process the data yourself, meaning you have your in-house staff that might have degrees in statistics, probably more on, for example, you're talking about health, they're public health graduates, or they have a degree in epidemiology. It will really depend on what your area of concern is. So if you have these people as part of your team, as part of your LGU, then you can consider your in-house staff to possibly process and manage this data. But if not, you have the capacity to reach out to national government, particularly DICT, DOST. If you're talking about health, maybe DOH, because they have expertise there, DENR, if about environment. If you want a bit about labor and employment, you have DOLE, among others. So basically, national government is there. And of course, who can forget the Philippine Statistics Authority that are actually providing a lot of technical assistance to LGUs also. In my experience in PopCom, we work a lot with PSA because they are able to help us process all the data very, very fast. But if government is not your way to go, you can actually also collaborate with the private sector and private firms. Plus, you can even reach out. And this is why stakeholder analysis is very important. You can actually even reach out to both local and national members of the academe. You have a lot of universities providing technical assistance to LGUs. as part of their learning programs as well. So not only are you helping train students and expand the research, let's say, of the schools, the professors, and the like, but you're actually getting the chance to get the information that you need based on the data that you collected. And this is why collaboration is key, right? So let's move forward. What are your considerations now? Where do you get reference data? Because you might be thinking, okay, I have all of this data, but what does this mean in the greater scheme of things? Well, you can now juxtapose this information that you were able to collect and effort and also process with information that's readily available. You can use them as your jump off point or your springboard as to how you'll be able to process everything else. So you can check data.gov.ph. You have your World Bank open data. You can even have your PhilGEPS data portal and even the EFOI portal or the Electronic Freedom of Information portal, right? So those are all available for your use. And I think one of the ways that we can better characterize this would be to hear more about the interactions of MBC when it comes to working, I believe, with a private partner when it comes to data processing. And for this, I would love to call on Ms. Gita to share more.
Thank you, Dex. As you can see on screen, we have two different analyses of the data. On the right side, you have the analysis from Polis, which is an artificially intelligence-driven data analysis. And then on the left side, you have the analysis from LayerTech, which is a data science firm based in Albay. So during the first digital democracy run in 2020 in Pasig, we had the benefit of Polis founder Colin McGill explain the data received from the survey. In 2021, we realized that although Polis does provide initial analysis, we thought it would be very important to get insights from the data. So we partnered with data science firm LayerTech in Albay to provide an analysis of the data and generate insights on the feedback collected through the poll. So in your own LGU, we do recommend identifying at the initial stages who will be conducting the data analysis of your information. Do you have someone in your team who can do this, or do you need to reach out to an external partner like Dr. Dex mentioned earlier? So whatever you decide, it's better to reach out early and have the partner data analyst review your survey questions even before you launch it so that they can already identify some things that are repetitive or some things that may not yield the answers that you need. So thank you so much. Back to you, Dex.
Thank you for that, Ms. Gita. And at this point, I would love to ask our participants in this learning session, can you identify at this point in time who would be able to analyze your data? Who, if you already are processing data, who is analyzing your data right now? So please do share it with me in the comment section the chat box so that we can learn a little bit more about who can possibly process and analyze the data that you will be collecting. So I think we have some responses already. We have here from the LGU of Bulacan, their planning department. Okay, so that would be good if there are some LGUs that have specific areas or groups that are actually assigned to just process the data and lead into the planning department. See, it really is driving forward the planning process as well. So thank you. If you have others, please do share them in the chat box. So let's move forward with our continued discussion. So again, these are your open data resources. So let me now jump into the fifth step, which would be conducting the closing of your citizen assembly or closing the assembly to make it simpler, right? So what does this particular step entail? We want you to present now the results and the analysis for co-creation of programs and policies. Now that you have collected the data, you have processed them and turned them into information that can be readily understood by the public, it is now your duty and obligation to present them back to the group that helped you get that information in the first place. And now they feel that they're really more invested. It's really part of participatory governance, and that would be key for compliance later on. So when it comes to creating the report or your feedback to the general population, or at the very least, the citizens' assembly that you have brought together, you of course would have to factor in the TLDR, or too long didn't read version of your report, the executive summary. This summarizes your entire purpose, the process that you underwent, and the key factors that were considered, plus the results and the outcomes of the study. And of course, you have to include there very briefly what comes next, what program, what policy will be coming the way of your constituents, your people, right? And once you are able to communicate that, it would be good. And this is where the question a while ago, the question that was raised during the coffee break, regarding what would be considered irrelevant, relevant, etc. This is the time that you're able to open the floodgates for the discussion of other things, particularly the conduct of your informal side sessions, to just validate, based on the data that you collected, what would now be the area that would be of a concern to possibly an area that you missed, or does the data that you were able to collect really reflect what the people think? Or were there some limitations because of the way that you phrased the survey questions, or maybe the way that you distributed the survey was very limiting? So now you have to check and ensure that there is congruence in that. And for some LGUs, particularly those that include interventions already as part of the considerations, to do trial runs. For example, you wanted to do a citywide implementation of a policy as a result of your digital democracy initiatives. Maybe you can first do a trial run that's based on that, just to see if there is congruence. Everything has to be aligned. Everything has to be properly appropriated for your target demographic. Then, of course, once all of these are done, you would now look into handing it over to the decision makers. You hand over the results so that you'll be able to inform those who are in power, the elected officials, or those in charge of creating the policy or crafting the program, to know more about the results of your digital democracy initiatives. So it is actually recommended as a way to get the people really invested in the process, for them to even be the ones to hand it to the decision makers as a cherry on top to really push that collaboration for participatory governance. And of course, to better improve the awareness of the public, online sharing and promotion of the results of the study or your digital democracy initiative would be very important, so that not only now are the citizens assembly that you have gathered be the ones knowing about the results, but everyone, all of your constituents, all of those that are under your jurisdiction or your care would be informed. And that would actually set a good precedent, because they will find out that, my LGU, my government agency, is taking a very clear step towards learning more about what I think would be helpful, what I think would be important, and what steps can be taken by government to make all of our lives a little bit better every day. So with that being said, I think it would be now important to maybe listen to some of the key results of the previous runs of the Digital Democracy Initiative in the four cities that they have been implemented in. So with that, I'd love to call back Ms. Catch to share more about MDC's experiences.
Thanks, Dex. So in Pasig 2020, policymakers generally, or they told us that they found the discussion helpful because it revealed areas where constituents agree and disagree with their policy. So if your constituents agree with your policy, they know where you're going right. But on areas of disagreement, you know where else you need to improve. So for example, in Pasig, active transport is a divisive issue. Not everybody agrees that pedestrians can or should walk on roads in addition to or instead of sidewalks. But we found that child safety, so everybody agrees that children should have safe places to play in urban places. If you frame it as a child safety initiative, along with an active transportation initiative, you're more likely to get more people involved and you're more likely to get your constituents to comply. On another thing, in Pasig 2021, for a second digital democracy run with them, that was when they were considering enforcing a lower speed limit. So based on the feedback that they received, which had quite a bit of pushback, they decided that they'll focus on the consistency of enforcement and try to address the concerns of their constituents first before going on a full rollout. In Intramuros, it's similar results. The results of the citizen assembly were presented to the Intramuros administration in their board meeting, and they used that to further design measures to address the key concerns regarding heritage conservation. So they're working on this initiative and they're planning to implement a program to divert roads, as explained by Mr. Yap earlier. In Legazpi, since we actually have somebody from Legazpi now, could we call on Sir Chito Ante from Legazpi to provide more info on what he's doing now or what Legazpi is doing now? Sir Chito, could you share with us or share with the group?
Okay.
Hi, Sir
good
Chito.
Morning.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, Dr. Dex, Ma'am Gita, and Ma'am Katz, and to all who are with us today. First of all, I would like to thank everybody, especially the two angels from NBC, for really supporting the city of Legazpi. Now, as far as what now, right after this this session, the mayor now told us now to put up a team in order to go over the result. In fact, I went to our partner, so the SADP representative from LEPO, or local, and then from BPLO, from PESO, at the same time from CPDO. And then we have now what we call a dialogue with those who had been participants in this, the result, particularly we went into support needed by this, we try to in fact we went through our EIP to the progress that hopefully in our same time to the for the recommendation, we have now the portal, the what we call the portal. Anytime that will now be inaugurated in order really to engage with our people, particularly these groups, MRSE. Then we, as far as the taxes by the small and medium enterprises, and we are trying out to study not only the based on the ARTA, but basically at least one step, and that was to limit it or to put it on in one step, because they are a special breed of entrepreneurs, so we have to protect this group, and then basically for them now to access their, in other words, their legal protection in terms of licenses, because as far as licenses are concerned, they cannot qualify because of the so much cost. Right now, we are trying to review this, especially the requirement coming from the health, requirement coming from the national government, and hopefully, if we will be given that particular authority, those whose income or capitalization less than 10,000 will be coming up now with a new policy. In other words, policy that we, and hopefully to protect this group. And as far as the training is concerned, we are in coordination now with our partner CSO in trying now to design the module. And as far as the PESO is concerned, the PESO is not only focused on employment, but rather we are now focusing it now in how for this small business now, in other words, to level up basically, because we want this now to be our employers rather than for this now to preparing the city for employment purposes. But we want also to prepare our people to be the employer of our people within the city. Then, so right now, we are now In other words, constrained by the election ban, basically. And hopefully after this ban, we'll try to move further. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sir Chito. So as Sir Chito was mentioning, in Legazpi and in Iligan City, the results of the citizen assemblies are being used to craft plans to support small businesses. So these plans will be reviewed and acted upon once election seasons are over. Back to you, Doc Bex.
Right. Thank you very much for that. And I think that is a manifestation of the impact that digital democracy can do in the way that your LGU runs. And I believe we see here a proof of concept as to why we highly encourage everyone in this call, in this learning session, to enact digital democracy initiatives. So let's jump to the very, very last step, which would be, of course, let me just do that very quickly and share a little bit more. So this is more of the feedback, a throwback of the other successful results that we have had for digital democracy. So the very last step would be to complete the loop. Now, this is where everything comes together and you now move forward to enacting your steps towards making things happen. So enacting your observable actions resulting from the consultation, because we don't want to just keep consulting and consulting and consulting and then nothing happens. We just collect data and then that's it. No, that should not be the case, because we want to use the data, turn it into information, turn it into information, and then eventually turn that information into something that will be acted upon. And therefore, it would be imperative for us to avoid the analysis paralysis. And that is something that digital democracy is actively espousing. That's why we aim to always close the loop. And that is why, as part of your endeavors and as part of this learning session, especially for the workshops tomorrow, we will be helping you create your action plans. And there is actually a step-by-step process for that. Of course, we want you to first process or even know the existing policies and programs of your LGU, your municipality, or your government agency. First, you have to know what exists now so that you can use that as a reference as to whether you will tweak something, propose something totally new, link things together, or separate things if they are not working well. So you have to understand your own context and what currently exists in order to find out the lay of the land. Then you set the agenda. What happens next? Do we push forward with the data collection first? Do we see first the legalities of things? Do we get the nod first of the head decision maker to proceed? And you have to now consider the next steps. What will you do? Will you now enact the program? Will you be able to roll out the resources necessary for it, etc.? And of course, you execute the plan. Because at the end of the day, we want to provide the service to our constituents and provide the service to those that have given us the opportunity to learn more about them. Let's use their data for their benefit. So on the right, you're going to see just a quick snapshot of possibly one of the ways that you can go through this. You have your starting phase. You're introducing digital democracy initiatives to your LGU, possibly through your EOs, your memoranda, amongst others. Then possibly legislate or probably create a program depending on the nature of your engagement. And then, of course, ending always with step three, which is full implementation of the program. And if that is probably a bit more complicated for you, we can use it in the sense for those who are more accustomed with the business language. So in the same way that you would first have to understand your business, you then would need to understand the data that is made available to you. Then you prepare that data and you model it so that you'll be able to better get the information that you need to analyze the situation, evaluate and present the results to your constituents, and then deploy. Here is the result. This is my action plan. I will implement that action and repeat the cycle over and over again, because digital democracy in general is a way to improve your current processes and to enhance the systems that are currently in place. And that is the beauty of participatory governance, of good governance in general, in a world that's now really shifting towards e-governance use more and more. So this is what you'll be using tomorrow. This is the action plan template. I'm already introducing it to you today so that you'll be a little bit more familiar when it comes to filling this out. Because for today, your task, don't worry, it's going to be quite simple, would be to just first analyze what main issue we would like to talk about, right? So, but before we go to your breakout sessions, and don't worry, it's going to be very brief, very quick. I'd love for all of you to once again visit our Menti and probably scan the QR code or input our voting codes so that, oh, looks like there really was a runaway winner with just, I believe, this TikTok answer here is coming from a young public servant. From the last question, because based on the recent study that we've conducted in Popcom and NEDA, Facebook is still king in the Philippines, followed surprisingly by TikTok, then YouTube, and then Instagram, and then Twitter. So that is for the Filipino population. But my question now is actually not that, but of course, this is something that you'll be answering in your breakout session later. But for now, I would love to ask all of you to please, before we go to your breakout sessions, how would you rate your learning experience today? Please do tell us, please do tell Experto Play Labs as well as the Makati Business Club, how did you feel about your learning session today? And hopefully we can continue to collaborate with you and give you better insights on how to roll out your digital democracy programs in your locality. So please keep sending those questions in. Your feedback is very, very important to us. And hopefully we'll be able to make your learning session a bit more encouraging and hopefully technically supportive